Brother DJ, how you doing, fam? You too, if I done hit something wrong, because this ain't all the way it's supposed to be. Maybe it's a possibility I pushed the wrong button, y'all. Give me a second here. We're going to talk about success today. I do not own the rights to this music, y'all, but I did grow up playing it a lot. It's that real music, so I do not own the rights. I wish I did. I wish I did, but I do not. I cannot tell a lie to y'all. I do not own the rights to this music, so please don't nobody think I'm trying to monetize it and make money off of it. I just wanted to share some good music with y'all because that's what I was listening to. YouTube, how you doing in there? Instagram, Facebook, how y'all doing? I appreciate if y'all could share this. Wanted to have a conversation about success. You know, I've been talking with doing a lot of coaching lately, and it's a lot of disturbing conversations going on dealing with gentrification. So we got to talk about it, y'all. You know, I'm not trying to put nobody's business out there in the street. So if you feel like I'm telling your business, please don't think I am, because I don't name names. But I do talk about scenarios that's going on in the community that I hear about. And, you know, when I coach people, I find out about all types of situations. And it's a little discouraging. It makes me want to talk about it so that others won't make the same conversations. You know what I'm saying? It's like, why do you got to create the wheel? Why should you make mistakes doing something that somebody else failed at doing, you know? When we could talk about it today and talk about how people are making mistakes, how we could talk about how people are becoming successful and how success is destroying some people because they wasn't ready for success. So that's why I entitled this one, Are You Ready for Success? I don't own the rights to that music either, y'all. When y'all hear this kind of music that I'm playing, that y'all know who I am. That's the kind of stuff I grew up with. El Moreno, what's going on? Lynette. How was your weekend, y'all? Hope y'all had a blackificent weekend like I did. But some of y'all, it ain't over yet. You know what I'm saying? Some of y'all got another day off tomorrow, so hopefully we're going to use it for some good things. Excuse me for being in my face when I'm on, when I be on here, y'all. It's just when I come on here, it's like a big old mirror. And it just whoop, blow your face up, and you like, oh, I got a piece of lint on my beard. Oh, I got something in my nose. I'm not trying to gross y'all out. But y'all be knowing, but y'all don't say nothing. So if y'all want to say something, chime in, hit the link to let me know to bring y'all in. I forgot to put the Cash App link in there, so if anybody wanted to make a donation or anything, they can go to Thomas TJ Lofton, L-O-T-I-N. Y'all know my website is thomastjlofton.com. And my books are on my website for sale. So let me get ready to chime this out over here. I was just allowing some more YouTubers and people, because I have not been on YouTube in a while. My apologies, y'all. I've been on the move. That's why I was telling y'all, they want me to get 1,000 subscribers on YouTube before I can start going live on YouTube. Let me go and cut that off before they turn around and say, you don't own the rights and you've been using stuff that ain't yours. I would like to figure out how to fix this. It asked me, do I want to see chats? And I put no. YouTube, can you say something on here? Somebody type in, where you at? What's your city? What's your state in? Where you at? I would think that it ain't showing. I want to talk about success. Okay, let me tell y'all what I've been doing. Y'all know I've been sound like a radio up loud in the background. I hear it. But this weekend, February the 8th, I will be in Atlanta, Georgia. Actually, I will be in y'all know, I'll just be like, hold that thought right quick, y'all. Hold on 1 second, y'all. Let me go fix something real quick. Mr. Big Stuff, who do you think you are? Mr. Big Stuff, she gonna get my love, y'all. Mr. Jerome, what's going on? Miss Bree, what's going on? Miss Bree, you see, I did that video you asked me to do about the gentrification investments. I did that on one of my videos the other day for you. I was alive, and I think I was sitting in front of Simply Wholesome, if I'm not mistaken. And I said, let me go on and do this. But I'll be in Decatur, Georgia, coming up on February the 8th. I'll be out there doing Meet the Author book signing at the Listening Tree Bookstore. I've never done a book signing there before, and they sell my books for quite some time now. And I appreciate that. Oh, wow. Speaking of books, let me write that down. Sometimes you got to write stuff. I got to write stuff down, y'all. Y'all send this and share this if y'all don't mind. Be kind and please share. How you doing? Patrice, how y'all doing? I appreciate y'all. Man, it feel good to be back live and being able to share with my family about some of the things going on, about some of the things I'm doing. Y'all know Black History Month. They say the master them give us a month to talk about us, you know. Y'all get to hear about Martin Luther King again. But we know that Black History is every day. 365, period. 24/7, 365 is Black History Month. So please don't fall for that, y'all. You know what I'm saying? We schools and colleges who need government money are only allowed to talk about it for 30 days. So better yet, it's only 28, 29 days in February. That is my birthday month, y'all. So of course they give us the smallest amount of time to talk about us. And then they're going to pump up Martin Luther King again, get to talk about the everyday people that you've been knowing about since you learned about since you was a kid. And now your children and grandchildren learn about the same people, as if we don't have no other Black people who've done amazing things. But that opens the door for us to say, hey, I read about this great dude on Facebook, and I want to talk about him in Black history this year. You know, so those of y'all who are doing the work and letting people know, you know, bringing in these other scholars that did great things, these other legends in our community, bringing them in to speak, I appreciate y'all, or bringing them in to bringing their book in, or bringing in who they are, what they've done, their accomplishments. I appreciate y'all. Just like I bought in for my end of the year event, my Kwanzaa event, I bought in Dr. Joseph Jackson, Leo Sullivan, Isaiah Cooper, some living legends, you know, that's done amazing things. Leo Sullivan was the one who created the, he did the Fat Albert and the Gang cartoons. He did the illustrations and the cartoons for those. And he did all those old cartoons, y'all. All the stuff that people in my age range grew up on. This dude is in his 70s, man. And I was honored to have him there. I'm honored to have Leo and a lot of my friends to be my friends, because we all share the same goal, is to help our people. Kevin, what's going on, fam? You know, I appreciate everybody who tune in and share. You know, I heard somebody say something about some football or something on. So if y'all ain't watching football, or Who Shot Ghosts and all that old kind of stuff, I appreciate that. You know, that y'all sharing with me. Matter of fact, I was driving down the 405 freeway, and they had this big old giant building, and it had a big old wrap on the building, or paint on the building, that said, Who Shot Ghosts? On the side of the building. And I thought, like, wow, that's crazy. You know, I grew up with stuff like that. And cats would, I hate it when people call me, you know, such and such shot such and such. I'd be like, hold on, man. I don't want to hear that. You know, don't be calling me, telling me that. So when I seen that on the billboard, people call me asking me who shot people, who did what. And I hated that. You know what I'm saying? Because you always have that thought in the back of your mind, that you know the phone is tapped, you know somebody's sitting there listening, so why would you be asking somebody stuff like that over the phone, or period? You know, in this economy, you know, I remember growing up back in the day. Now I'm sidebarring, y'all. Now I'm going to the left. I'm going off and to the left here. I remember growing up, and we would always be very weary of who's snitching. Who's the snitch in the group that's telling on folks, you know? People going to jail for stuff, somebody telling on people. So we would always be weary of that. You know, and then certain people would ask questions like, who shot Ghost? And you'd be like, why? Why are you concerned about that? Oh, I was just wondering. Why are you wondering? You know what I'm saying? So they're going to tell on somebody, right? They're going to tell. So they might have a microphone on recording the conversation. And now that you know, you're going to jail too. So I don't like stuff like that, y'all, when I see people doing that. You know, so now where we would wonder who was snitching and who was recording these phone calls, or who had a wire on, now everybody's wearing the wire. You know what I'm saying? What do I mean by that? Everybody got a cell phone, and the cell phone is recording everything you say, y'all. So I just want y'all to know that everything you talk about, everything you say, everything you do, even when your phone is turned off, they recording it. They hear you. Even when your phone is remember how back in the days, people would take their battery out their phone. Kevin, what's up, fam? People would take their battery out their phone so that you cannot be heard. But guess what? They fixed that now. Phones, you can't take the battery out no more, because they don't want you making the phone where they can't hear you no more, because we didn't all accept these links. We've all accepted on Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, whatever it is you got, social media, that yes, you can record me. Yes, you can use my video camera on my phone when you want to. Yes, you can use my phone whenever it is you want to against my will. Yes, you can. Because we don't really know what we're doing. People just say yes just to get that app. You know what I'm saying? Anthony, what's going on, fam? So it's things like that that we have to be careful of. So no, I don't like that. People be on there screaming, who shot who? And next thing you know, they recording them. And next thing you know, you're wondering, why does such and such go to jail? They sitting there giving up murders and don't realize they're being recorded by their own phone. we talk about people who are stupid going live, counting money and all of that kind of stuff. Some of them people didn't go live. You know what I'm saying? But their camera was being recorded because they said there are some keywords that you can use, family. You know, Miss Katrina, how you doing? There are some keywords that you can use that'll make your phone start recording you. Did y'all know that? There are certain words that you can use, and you got your phone laying on the bed, sitting on a dresser, or on the, in the cup holder in the car, and you driving down the road, and you there are certain words that you then said, like, who shot ghosts? You know what I'm saying? And boom, your phone starts automatically recording you, and the video camera comes on to get everybody in the car or in the house with you. Whatever it can see, it's going to record it because you done said them trigger words that make your camera cut off. So that was my sidebar that I just wanted y'all to share, because when normally what people see in society, they tend to do it in real life. So normally things that they want us to do, make stupid decisions, say stupid things, they're going to put it on TV. They're going to put it on the side of the billboard, a building, whatever it is. So like I said, they got this thing talking about who shot ghosts, and people are running around saying that. And then it rolls over into who shot that guy on Western. You know what I'm saying? Who was behind and all that stuff. And they recording that conversation. So anyway, I just wanted to share that. But I want to talk about success, y'all. I've been doing a lot of consultations lately. Oh, man, I've been like, wow. I'm just humbled and thankful that people are looking up to me as the person, the real estate expert, you know what I'm saying, the business expert that we can call TJ. He has shown us that he knows a lot about these things. So people call me for coaching. So I'm always sitting down coaching and giving a consultation online or something. And the things that they come up with and tell me, I just be like, wow. You know, so me as a businessman, you know, I've been in business my whole life, literally since I was like 6 years old. I was always a hustler, you know what I'm saying? Buying candy, selling it at school, something. You know, I grew up selling mixtapes and stuff like that because I always wanted to make some money. Miss Danielle, how you doing? I always wanted to make some money. So I've always been a hustler because I was told by my mom when I was growing up that instead of saying I don't have the money to afford that, that you can buy that stuff that you want, I was told you don't need it. So I heard that a lot. So that was trigger words for me to realize early on that I need to figure out how can I make a living without being in my mom's purse all the time. So, you know, I wanted to be more independent. So I became a hustler. Everything I can sell, I'm going to sell. Can I cut your grass? Can I come clean up your car, wash your car for you? I had a lawn service growing up. I had a car washing business. I had a clean up your garage service. I didn't did it all, y'all. I didn't did it all. So nobody was surprised when I grew up building low riders. I was attracted to these brothers sitting in his garage, Gary, you know what I'm saying? Homer Walters, all these kind of cats sitting in their garage, Terry Carter working on cars. And I was like, wow, they making money. So I noticed that. I said, they making money. I need to pay attention to that. So anyway, success. I've been talking to a lot of people in coaching, and conversations that's been coming up, y'all, it's really concerning. You know, I put that book out, Monetizing Gentrification, because I knew back in 2000 and I think it was four. That's exactly what it was. When I was in divorce court, I sat in divorce court for some years, right? I was in divorce court for about 3 years, rounded off, right? And I saw people beating themselves up, beating each other up over money in the house. Whenever divorce, let me tell y'all, during the years of 2002 to 2006, that was a booming real estate market in America. And it was the fastest, Palmdale, California was the fastest growing city in America at that time. So whenever you inflate money into the neighborhoods, into the city, you're gonna have an effect, so a harsh effect. So many people's had houses had went from 100,000 to half a million, like in 2 or 3 years. So all of a sudden, people start pulling money out of their houses. People started getting divorces because they didn't want to pull the money out of the house. And some the husband or the wife did, hypothetically speaking, or they pulled the money out of the house and somebody wanted to go buy a new car and some rims and somebody else wanted to buy a bigger ring. So a lot of that stuff ended up in divorce court. And I got to see what was cool for me, but I didn't realize it at the time. when I was going through my divorce court stuff, my stuff was so bad per the judge that the judge decided to put me on last. He said, this Lofton stuff is so bad that I want them to go last. Every time we go to court, we got to be there at 8:30, but I already knew he was not going to see us until about 4:30 that evening because he did not want to deal with us because he knew it was too much controversy behind this wedding, this divorce. So fast forward the story, I got to sit there and listen to hundreds of people's divorces and why did they divorce? What were they fighting over? What did they have? And me being a real estate businessman, I'm like, these people ain't got nothing to be fighting over. Then you got people who never had nothing, but they owned a house and they were struggling to pay for that house. Daniela, how you doing? Michelle, how you doing? You know, they over here fighting over this house. And then the judge would ask them, you know, the judge always try to tell people, why don't y'all go out in the hallway and mediate? Did y'all mediate? Did y'all try to work this divorce out? And the people would be like, no. Judge would be like, go in the hallway and see if y'all can work it out before we start dividing stuff up. And some people would be like, Your Honor, he did, and she did that, and she this. And they would tell why they don't want to stay married. And I noticed the people with the money, the people with the house that skyrocketed in equity, they couldn't work it out. Those were the ones that could not work it out. I noticed that. You got $100,000 in equity in your house, they could not work that marriage out. The ones who did not have no money, the ones that was broke, I mean, the ones that was struggling, that needed each other, oh, they was the ones that worked it out. And that taught me a lesson right there. It's like, this money really is affecting our community, y'all. So I would listen to them talk. And I appreciate y'all can share this video because somebody need to hear this. You know, when I get to venting, you know, there's always somebody going to hear something that could help them. So I appreciate if y'all could share or subscribe or follow, whichever it is, YouTube, you can subscribe, hit that button, that bell, or whichever. Facebook, Instagram, follow, share these videos with people, share it into your favorite group. I'd appreciate it. You know, so I listened to people, the people who did not have anything to fight over, they was barely making it. They was just living. You know what I'm saying? It'd be like, he cheated on her, she cheated on him. And the judge would ask him, do you love him? And she'd be like, yes. Do you love her? He'd be like, yes. Is this something you think you could work out? And it'd be like all guilt then set in. It'd be like, she's about to be gone. I'm about to be on my own. It ain't no fun dating all these different girls. I know I was just doing the most and being stupid. So yes, Your Honor, I think I can try to fix this. I apologize. And I sit there right in front of my eyes like, wow, this brother just confessed that he messed up and he's willing to try to fix it. You know what I'm saying? And she took him back. He was screwing her friend. He was screwing her sister. She was sleeping with his brother, the guy next door. And they're going to fix it and work it out? I was like, whoa, that's some love right there. But the people who said, Your Honor, I just want my money and I'm out. You know, I'm like, wait a minute. It was like we only paid $90,000 for, like, especially in Palmdale. It tripped me out in Palmdale. They paid $90,000 for a house. And then 4 years later, all of a sudden it's worth $450 or something like that. And all of a sudden they fighting because he won't let her pull money out the house so she can go get her a brand new car and some brand new furniture and stuff like that. And he like, no, we don't want to touch it. Or she like, no, I don't want you to pull no money out the house because I don't want you going to buy a new car and some big rims and all that old stuff. They'd end up in divorce court. And the judge would ask them, do y'all think y'all could work this out? And they'd be like, no, hell no. Excuse my language, y'all. No, we can't work it out. Why you can't work it out? Because I'm tired of him being so controlling. I'm tired of her being so controlling. Wait a minute. What do you mean by controlling? Meaning he's telling me no. She's telling me no, that we can't touch this money in this house. Y'all hear what I said? Key word is house. We can't access this money. Somebody in this marriage does not want me to does not want the other to access the money so that they can go blow it on something unnecessarily. When I listen to the stories, it was very much never that the someone, that was my story though. I'm selling houses so I can go open up businesses and buy more houses. And I was told no. And I'm like, I was doing that before I met you. So now I'm having a problem. You got to go because you can't stop me from continuing to make a living. This amazing lifestyle you're living is from me flipping these houses and buying houses and more businesses and manufacturing stuff. So I don't need you in the way. You're hindering things. So you need to go. So the other people would be, they want to sell, they want to pull the money out of the house so they can go buy some rims and a new car. And I've had clients that came to me. I remember a brother had a Oldsmobile Cutlass, and he was struggling to fix that car up and keep that car going. That car was worth every bit of $800. And he was every penny he got, he sunk into that car. And when he came up on some that house, they had a little bitty old house out there. I ain't gonna tell y'all where. I don't want nobody thinking I'm singling out talking about them. So this brother had his girlfriend told him, y'all, we're gonna buy a house together. So they put their money together and they bought the house. And all of a sudden, that house had about $400,000 in equity in the house, and he wanted to sell that house immediately, access that money. And do you know that dude sold that house and went and bought him a $100,000 convertible lowrider? And next thing you know, him and his wife end up divorced because he forced her to sell that house because he wanted that money out of that house. And his old vision, it wasn't even about buying another house. It was, he was more bent and driven on getting a new car that he can get out there and clown with. He ended up getting a convertible lowrider worth $100,000. I ain't gonna tell y'all the kind of car he bought. Some of y'all lowrider guys know what he bought, what kind of car that fits that $100,000 range. And he went and bought a brand new truck with some big wheels on it and some music. That's why a lot of women hated me growing back in the days, because those guys would bring me the money. TJ, I want to buy that car from you. And I'm sitting there thinking, dude, you worth about $800. How you gonna go give me $100,000 for this car over here? Oh, I just sold my house. I'd be like, huh? And you bringing $100,000 to me to buy a car? Did you invest the money in something else? No. Did you get some stocks or something? No. Did you go invest in a rapper or something? No. What'd you do with them? Oh, I bought a truck. I bought some rims, bought some music. After a while, y'all got tired of that, and I start checking these brothers. Look, dude, this is what you need to do. And a lot of them brothers I checked and I taught the game to, they became millionaires and are still successful to this day, because it took for somebody positive to be in their life and whisper something in their ears or say, you know what, man, I don't want your money. You ain't finna give me no money, you know, because I know you can't afford to do what you about to do with this money. But anyway, it was things like that that destroyed marriages to this day. So here we are again, history repeating itself. Gentrification at an all-time high. Real estate at an all-time high. Real estate has never before in U.S. history been as expensive as it is today. So guess what, family? We are having more divorces than we've ever had before in U.S. history. Again, we already went through that in 2002 to 2006. Now here we go again. Same thing happening again. Whenever there's an influx of money into the community, you got a whole lot of people that's going to fight over. So I ask that question again. Are you ready for success? Anybody got any questions for me? Please feel free to chime in. But we got a lot of people who they are not ready for success because when money comes, they lose their mind. So I was sitting down with some people over the last few days, different people, and it's like really starting to get to me because people are like, man, you know, they fighting over money again. They fighting over the equity in the house. You know, you got people's parents that's passing away and people don't have no will, y'all. And that's a big thing. We got to get some wills together. Tax season is coming. Some people will be getting 7,000 to 10,000 racks refunds. I hope that you do a video with some tips on what to do with that money, because that job market is changing. Patrice, you are absolutely right. And guess what? This can be the video. You know what I'm saying? Are you ready for success? Success is getting $7,000 to $10,000 in tax return money. And you're supposed to be using that money for investments, family. Let's talk about that. Patrice say, give some tips. Oh, y'all caught me at a good time. Let's talk about some tips. And feel free, anybody on this live, to throw out some tips as well. Please throw out some tips and help a brother out because there's some investments all around the country that I don't even know of that's amazing. But how about this? Let's get even more about it. There are some investments that people are making that they're pitching to the Black community that are not good investments. So if y'all throw out some of these things that you're being pitched to or being told to about making a good investment, if y'all throw it out and I see it, I'm gonna be like, heck no, that ain't a good one. Leave that alone. Like people talking about take your $7,000 invested in the stock market. That would be a big negative. No, do not do that. I wish you could talk to my teenage sons. They want to start businesses, and one of them went to the class to get his auction license. Now, see, that is a great investment. If you say, hey, I'm going to take my my $10,000 tax return and we're going to invest it in my son because he just went and got his auction license. TJ, is that a good idea? I'd be like, absolutely a great idea. But please take my class. Please sit down with me for a consultation at least. Take the class and let's talk about it. Let me teach you the auction game. You know what I'm saying? So I can make sure you don't go in there and be buying based on emotion. You know, I've been in the auction stuff buying cars for years, y'all. And every time I go, I be on me. I be like, ooh, I want that. Ooh, man, I need that one too. Man, that Cadillac. Ooh, I need that Range Rover, that convertible Bentley. I need all of them. They be like, all 10 of them? I be like, yeah. Like, which one are you going to drive? I be like, all of them. You know what I'm saying? So I even get caught up, y'all. I can't lie. You know, one time I went to the auction. No, let me quit lying. This happened a bunch of times. I go to the auction, and I'm so busy thinking about me, I forget completely about flipping. Like, wait a minute. The purpose of coming to the auction is to invest this money and buy something that you can sell and make a nice profit off of and go back and buy more cars with the money, with the profit, you know? So let me give you an example of what a good investment looks like. Go to the auction and spend $1,000. And then all of a sudden, the car be worth $3,000, and you turn around and put the car up for sale with minor repairs. Maybe it need a tire. Maybe it need a car wash, a detail the interior, or somebody bust the window out to steal the radio. So now you put a new $50 window in there and a new $100 radio, and boom, you put the car back on the market for $3,000. Now you make $3,000. You put your $1,000 back into the safe. Into the bank, wherever you choose to put it, the Black bank or the Black safe at your house somewhere between me and you. And you take that $2,000 and you put that back into the investments and do the same thing over again. Just keep repeating it. I think getting a license like real estate, insurance, carpentry, plumber, HVAC, paint classes, and get some of the certifications in data science and IT. IT is big money, y'all. No, hands down. You got to start your own business, though. You definitely want to start. Most things are really good as long as you have your own business. But if you don't have your own business, then you're kind of wasting your time. I think getting a license like real estate is great. Yes, you want to get your real estate license, but you want to be an investor in real estate as well. It's not all about helping other people find a house. You got to be an investor. A real estate license is worthless if you don't make investments for yourself. Insurance. Okay, yes, insurance is cool. You just have to have your own insurance office. Carpentry is a wealth creator, hands down. Carpentry is a wealth creator. Plumbing, anything that got to do with building a house from the ground up, I can see you becoming a millionaire. Anything that got to do with building a car from the ground up, I can see you becoming a millionaire. Paint classes, absolutely. HVAC, absolutely. And then most importantly, y'all, it's about Kaylee, what's going on, family? Calling you tomorrow. Since you're near me. Okay, let me know. It's about a business, family. Whatever you do, a trade is no good if you don't start your own business. Samir, how you doing, family? You know, I don't like when a person gets some good information and then they go, oh, I'm gonna go find me a job. I'm gonna go look for me a job. I got this good trade. I'm gonna look for me a job. And then all of a sudden they can't get, racism locks them out. Racism locks you out of carpentry all day. Folks do not want you, put it like this. Let me tell y'all how cold carpentry is, meaning anything that got to do with building a house from the ground up is carpentry, y'all. If Black folks decided we will no longer be putting our children in HBCUs, or we will no longer, we won't, matter of fact, let me rephrase that. let me restate this topic I'm about to say. If schools, if HBCUs decided that we will no longer be teaching all of these extra classes that don't equate to anything, we will only teach carpentry classes because we want our students to become land developers. We want them to be able to build infrastructure, and we're going to set them up to start businesses in these areas so that they can reap the benefits of this biggest industry in America right now. Industry in America right now is the housing boom, the housing construction. Every state in America is going through a housing boom. Every downtown state in America is going through a housing boom with multiple high rises going up. So if the HBCUs, which I'm picking on the HBCUs because these are black schools that look like me, even though they got a big influx of people who don't look like us enrolling in these schools, watering them down. So that opens the door for them to bring in white teachers. I call them the gentrifiers. But anyway, if they decided we will no longer be teaching basic classes that has nothing to do with economy, things that they can go out and get a job, we're only going to be teaching things that they can start, has to do with land development, manufacturing, and things like that, they will close those schools down immediately. Y'all hear what I just said? They will close them down. The government will stop funding those schools because they know those work. Those careers work. If you learn how to swing a hammer, hang drywall, put a roof on the house, do plumbing, and you are talking about the same conversation of entrepreneurship, you having that same the conversation of entrepreneurship and you talking about trades, that equates to multimillionaire. If you're talking about manufacturing, you learn how to build houses from the ground up and you decide I'm going to start my own business now because I've gotten the game from working for this guy for quite some time. I'm going to do my own thing now. And now all of a sudden you've been doing your own thing now. You decide, all of this brackets and stuff that I'm buying, these refrigerators, these dishwashers, these cooktops, you know what I'm saying, Viking, Sub-Zero, Wolf, I can make my own stove. I can make my own refrigerator. I can make some of these brackets to hold 2x6s together and all of that. Now you're talking about becoming a multi-billionaire. Because guess what? That's one of the biggest industries on the planet, and you're all of a sudden going to start making some of these parts. You become a known developer, a known builder, and you're making money hand over fist. So now you decide to start supplying others parts. That's opening the door for wealth. That's opening the door for becoming a billionaire. Plain and simple, hands down. That is exactly what happened to me. When I started, I learned in the garage for Gary May, learned Homer Walters, Terry Carter's, Ernest House, all these OG whales in the automotive industry was feeding into my life. And TJ, the cars. Don't think about nothing else. The cars. Just build cars. You'd be good. That was absolutely right. So now I came out of their garage from hanging with them to now I'm in my mama's backyard doing my own thing, right? Then I end up building my own shop, having my own lowrider shop. Then I started painting my own cars. Then I started manufacturing car parts myself. In fact, I know I just had some parts around here. I started building car parts and now I start seeing money that I've never seen in my whole life. It was like, whoa. So trades, y'all, it starts with the trades. So now you're talking about wealth building. But again, let me rewind this whole conversation back. Oh, by the way, if you would like me to work with your sons, your children, please let me know. I do coaching all day, every day. I do consultations all the time. That's why y'all be like wondering, where's TJ at? I only work with a certain amount of people at a certain time because honestly, I can't work with 10,000 people at once, y'all. I don't want to be like, oh, go to online to my training classes. I want to sit down with you one-on-one. I want to be looking at you on this computer, talking to you for an hour. And when you're telling me what you're thinking about doing, I want to be like, that's a good idea. Or no, that ain't a good idea. I want to be like, here you go. This is what you need right here. So reach out to me. Check my schedule. Let's make sure I got some time, which I do got some time. I just graduated a lot of my people. They moved on with the new year. So now I'm looking for some new people. So that's why you see me back on the road again, picking up people to teach. You know what I'm saying? I want to be able to work one-on-one with some people, just like on the 25th, January 25th, I'll be at the Crown Plaza. Y'all got to register by the day because, if I'm not mistaken, the price is about to double and go up. Right now, it's not double, but it's at $99. It's going to go to $149. 5.5 hours of us sitting there chopping it up with me, and we going through this presentation line by line, talking about money, talking about business, talking about what kind of money is being made right now. You know what I'm saying? I don't go to cities that I don't know nothing about. So when I'm in a city, when I'm in Atlanta, I can tell you all about Atlanta. When I'm sitting in L.A., I can talk about Compton, L.A., Watts, you name it, we're going to talk about it. We're going to talk about it. If you're talking about D.C., oh, I can talk all about D.C. Or I can go into detail about Maryland. You know what I'm saying? I can tell you where the money is. So that's why I want to sit down one-on-one. I'm not giving you a generic wealth building class. Here is a generic wealth building class. Follow these generic rules and you're going to be a successful person. That ain't how that work, y'all. That ain't how that work. Some things that will work in LA will not work in New York. Some things that will work in New York will not work in Georgia. Some things that will work in Georgia will never work in Atlanta. I mean, Alabama. Does that make sense, y'all? So you cannot just take a generic class on wealth building. I can't give you a generic class. Say, here go flipping. Flipping, here go flipping 101. That's why you don't say, oh, TJ will be in Las Vegas. Uh-oh, here we go. I'll call him back. Let me see. That's why you don't hear me saying TJ will be in Las Vegas on January 4th. Everybody fly to Vegas. I'm going to have a big old bad class. I don't get down like that because I can't talk to y'all about real estate from a perspective. My people be like, you gonna talk to me now? I need to talk. It's an emergency. Anyway, I guess I'm gonna have to wrap this up soon. It's been 42 minutes since we've been on. But anyway, I like to talk to people one-on-one. I like to go to the room, to the venues and talk to people about Georgia. I like to talk to people about Louisiana. I like to talk to people about D.C., excuse me, because I got some insight about what's going on in D.C., and I want y'all to be very clear. When you asking me questions about D.C., I want to be very clear that we are talking about the right street, that we are talking about the right neighborhood, the right city, and heck, I might even be riding through that neighborhood so that I can make sure I know exactly what I'm talking about. You see what I'm saying? It's like everybody think they got the recipe or the cure. Everything, different things work for different people, y'all. So that's why I travel a lot. You know, so if y'all want me to come to y'all city, please reach out to me and book me, bring me out to your state. I was on the phone. We in conversations about Alabama. I'm in conversations about all kinds of different states. And it's like, these cities got things going on that is absolutely insane that I'm like, wow, I can't even believe it half the time. You know, that's why I wrote my book. You know, I went to 15 states and I was like, this is insane. Ain't nobody going to believe this. I gotta write a book about it. I got to take some pictures because ain't nobody going to believe this, you know? So anyway, family, that's why I'm a big coach. I'm a big personal coach, personal consultant. So if you're looking at other people and you're trying to compare me, TJ should be like such and such. He do the same thing. No, I don't do the same thing. I'm a one-on-one kind of guy. You know what I'm saying? Yeah, I may go do hotels. I may go do certain events. But in L.A., I got a lot of people saying, TJ, gentrification is kicking our butt. Can you please have something in L.A.? And we could talk about it because you're from L.A. You know a lot about it. Yes, I do. Okay, so I'll be at the Crown Plaza. January 25th, I will be at the Crown Plaza, 5.5 hours. Family, we got a lot to discuss. But we ain't there to talk about the problems. We there to talk about the wealth building that's happening all around you. So instead of you just seeing it, I want you to be a part of it and benefit from it. Carnesha, how you doing, family? I want you to be a part of it and reap some success in it, you know. Now, don't think that you can't come from Atlanta to California, to the California class, because you can't. You know what I'm saying? Some people, like California people, they think, okay, well, I'm from California. I can't, you know, I want to go to Atlanta. Well, guess what? You might want to catch a flight from California to Atlanta to go to my class, because I'm going to be giving up some Atlanta game. So if you even thinking about considering moving to Atlanta, you may definitely want to come on out to the class, because I'm going to give it up to them. Now, if you're thinking about and you living in Atlanta or you living anywhere else in America and you thinking, wow, I need to know what's going on in California, fly on out here and we're going to talk about it. But I will answer your question if you have a question. You know, hey, have you been to Mississippi, TJ? Yes, I have been to Mississippi. What's your question? I will answer that question. You know what I'm saying? Hands down, no problems. You know, I want my people to succeed, because if you succeed, I succeed. So what I'm doing is I realize a lot of my people, you know, a lot of us as a people tend to copy each other. When we see one person doing successful things, then other people say, oh, well, he must got the blueprint. Let me copy it. So if I teach y'all about the real estate and how real estate really works, and about business and how business really works, about manufacturing, about how manufacturing really works, when you go do it and you start becoming successful, other people are going to copy you. They're going to say, can you show me how you did that? Where did you get that from? And you're going to tell them. And the next thing you know, they're going to start making money. And the next thing you know, somebody going to see them do it and they're going to make money then. And this thing keeps going on and on and on. And that's what I like about entrepreneurship, because I always relate entrepreneurship to like fruits. You got a piece of fruit. I always say the apple, right? You got an apple here, right? And then if I give you an apple off of my tree, which I call that the money tree, because it keeps producing. It's a producer. This tree in my backyard is a producer. It keeps producing good fruit. So now I'm getting these apples and I take it off the tree and say, here you go. You could take the seeds out of that apple and go plant them in your backyard. Eat the apple, eat the nourishment, and take the seeds out and go plant them in your backyard. And then you're going to have a tree that's going to bear seeds as well, bear fruit with seeds in it too. It ain't like none of this grocery store fruit that don't have no seeds in it. You don't want that fruit. That fruit ain't no good. That's stuff that don't even add up. It's like, wow, you bought fruit and there ain't no seeds in it. It ends with you. It's over with you. You can't use, nobody else is going to benefit from the fruit. So you want to have fruit with seeds in it. That's what I feel about education. You come home with a degree and then I say, can you teach me what you learned? And you be like, no, you go get your own degree. I'm like, you just spent 4.5 years learning something. Can you teach me what you just learned? No. You go get your degree so you can have yours. That's why I don't like that model. I like the model where somebody taught me and I taught some people and some people taught other people and we all keep eating. So the real model of fruit, the fruit has seeds in it. Seeds can be planted so it can grow more trees and other people can pick the fruit from those trees and go plant those seeds in their backyards. So they will never, ever have to come back to you and ask you, can I have another fruit? Can I have another apple? I'm like, didn't I give you some fruit off of a tree? Didn't you plant a tree in your backyard? You'd be like, I threw the seeds away. I'm sorry, I forgot. You ain't a serious person. I can't help you. I don't want to give you no information. If I gave you some apples off my tree and say, take these apples and go plant them in your backyard, and you will never, ever, 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 ever have to come back to me and ask me for some help, because I gave you the information you needed. My friends gave me the information that I needed to go plant them seeds in my backyard, and them seeds is reaping benefits and they're growing. That's why I can't go ask my friends for no money half the time. I'll be like, man, can I get some help? They'd be like, did you leave with the seeds, with the fruit? Did you plant them? I'd be like, yeah, I planted them. Did the trees grow? I'd be like, yeah, the trees grow. And they're like, well, what happened? I got to be like, my wife got the house with the tree in the backyard. I was kidding. But no, I'm like, I got the recipe. So my friends know TJ will be good. We ain't never got to ask him. He ain't never got to ask us for nothing. TJ's good because he got the recipe. He got seeds. He got the seeds. He got the fruit with the seeds in it, and he planted them in his backyard. So he's always going to eat. We ain't never got to worry about him coming back asking us for more help, because he got the recipe in his head. He was taught by the best of the best. He got the fruit. I saw the tree. He planted. It's growing. He eating. And the other people were eating too. So he ain't got to come and ask us for no help. And that's what's going on with me right now. People be like, TJ needs some money? They be looking at each other crazy. Like, he got the recipe. Be like, yeah, he chose not to to go back to building cars. Why? Because he wants to help everybody else. He's teaching the game now. See, that's a good step right there. He's teaching others. Well, that's what it was meant to do. Teach others how to plant a tree. Teach others how to give the apple to other people. So that's why I teach people one-on-one. So if you're interested in having some coaching, if you're interested in a training class, please sign up, family. I will be in LAX Airport at the Crown Plaza Hotel for those of y'all. Y'all like, oh, well, let me sign me up right now. People calling right now. I'm not done, y'all. Sorry. I'm not done right, y'all. Let me give me a minute. I'm going to call y'all back. When I get done, then we can get started. I'm going to be done in 10 minutes or less, trying to keep it up under that hour because y'all know I could talk. Anybody else got any questions for me? Other than that, family, I will be in Atlanta, Georgia, Decatur, Georgia, February the 8th at the Listening Tree Bookstore doing a book signing, and we're going to have a partial conversation about real estate. You know, it's no full-blown out presentation. It's just me and you and all the other people who show up for the book signing. They usually let me make a lecture, give a lecture about, you know, what's going on around the country or what's going on here in Georgia. But I will be promoting my event for that evening. So from 2 to 4, I'll be in Decatur, Georgia at the Listening Tree Bookstore. Come on out and support that Black-owned bookstore. And then from 6:30 to 8:30, I will be upstairs from Tassili's Raw Food Reality in Atlanta, Georgia. But the place, the name of the venue upstairs from Tassili's Raw Food Reality on 1057 Ralph David Abernathy Boulevard, it's called the I Am Ascension Temple. I will be upstairs. So if you're at Tassili's, the door to Tassili's, the restaurant, is on the left. That's another amazing Black-owned business. I will be at the door on the right, and you go up the stairs, and I will be in that first door on the left. That is the I Am Ascension Temple, and I will be up in there giving a full-blown presentation, talking about things that's going on in Georgia, things that's going on around the country, and why we need to invest. And if you need me to hold your hand, if you're interested in some training, if you're interested in a consultation, I will be there taking people's sign-ups and everything like that, and we can make some things happen, family. The very next day, Sunday, February 9th, I will be in Sumter, South Carolina. We will be there doing the same exact thing, having a Black Print 2020. I ain't even talked about the Black Print 2020, y'all. For 2020, family, it's so much stuff going on in the country that people are having problems. People are like, TJ, I've been trying to flip houses, and I can't find none. I can't find no contractors to work on the houses. The contractor ripped me off. TJ, I started a business, and then I lost the business because the landlord lost the building out from under me. He didn't tell me that he was going to sell the building, and he didn't tell me he was in foreclosure. So I had a problem. Person telling me about a person had a business, and the person wasn't paying the rent and all this stuff. Family, we're going to go in on those kind of things. We're going to talk about that because it's really happening right now, purely based on gentrification and the value of the real estate. Dura, what's going on, family? The value of the real estate has become so high. Tina, how you doing? The value of real estate nationally have become so expensive that it opened the door for a lot of trickery. A lot of devious things is going on around the country with people. I got people calling me, telling me they rented a house from someone that didn't even own the house and the police locked them out the house. I got people calling me saying that somebody's bought a house from somebody that didn't own the house and the police locked them out the house. I got people who said my bank closed down and they sold my loan. And I got people who saying that the city raised the taxes and they knew we couldn't afford to pay those taxes. So they took my house and all of that kind of stuff. So family, it's annoying when people call me at the last minute. I remember talking to Dr. Sabian, and he said, TJ, the biggest problem is Black folks wait to the last minute and they will come to his office and die on his couch, even though they knew for 5 months that they were sick and going to die. White guy told him 5 months ago, hey, you sick, you got cancer, you got diabetes, you got AIDS. And they wait to the last minute, all else failed. Then they come to my office after the white folks couldn't help them. Now they want to come to my office and they will die on the couch waiting. Before they even signed up to me to see them, they then died on the couch. I was like, that blew me away. So I'm going through the same type of things People call me and say, TJ, I got a sale date on my house. I want you to help me save my house. Can you help me? I'll be like, yeah, bring me your stuff over. When is the sale date? Tomorrow. I'll be like, tomorrow? It took a while for you to get a sale date. They'd be like, yeah, but you've been following me for the last year and a half, and you never thought maybe I need to call TJ. See, we tend to go to all these people that can't help us. But then at the same time, y'all, we got a lot of bamboozlers out here who talk a real good one but don't know nothing about anything. We got people who are changing lanes like crazy. We got people who will come into the game and say, oh, they going through gentrification. A lot of folks are selling their houses, got money. Oh, let me add a real estate class. Right now, I'm teaching about wills and trust and stocks. But now that they're making money off of gentrification, let me go hire somebody about real estate so I can put a class in my thing and say, hey, I'm teaching real estate too. So call me for your real estate needs, even though they don't know nothing about real estate. They just taking money, collecting money, and enjoying life, living their best life because you didn't decide to do your research. You know, you got attorneys who will say, oh, I do everything. No, you don't do everything. Either you're a probate attorney, you're a criminal law attorney, you're a real estate attorney, but you can't do everything. Oh, well, all these people work at my office, so collectively, and I hate when they say this, this is the biggest crock of crap I ever heard. Collectively, we got 80 years of experience in my office right here. Y'all hear what I just said? Collective, we got over 80 years of experience because we got a probate attorney in my office. We got a real estate law attorney. We got a divorce attorney, divorce law. We got civil rights attorney in my office. So collectively, we got over 80 years of experience in my office. So give me your money. No. You supposed to turn around and ask that attorney, what exactly did you graduate from law school with your degree is? What is your degree under? Huh? No, my office, we got 80. No. My question was, what did you graduate from law school? What is your degree under? And if they don't want to answer the question, you don't need them. I don't want to hear about 80 years of stuff. This cat didn't have his attorney license for every bit of 2 months. And now you about to give him $15,000 because he telling you he got 80 years of experience when the reality is he only had his license for 2 months. And he's pitching you to all these other people in his office that ain't got nothing to do with him. The reality is you're supposed to deal with a person who graduated in that field. So if you got a real estate law problem, you make sure that attorney you hire has a real estate license, a real estate law license, because that's what he specializes in. If you have a probate problem, you make sure you hire a probate attorney. You want to see that he is go to the website. Can I see where you graduated, a probate attorney? And I've been doing, we got 500 years of blah, blah, I don't care. Can you show me where you graduated, a probate attorney, before I give you my $15,000, before I turn around and hand you over my family's case worth millions of dollars? Can you, you need a criminal law attorney because your son is sitting in jail with murder charges or robbing a bank. That's criminal law. You can't go get the probate attorney for that. So it works the same way with real estate and business and who's teaching you the game. When you look TJ up, TJ got decades of real estate. TJ was reading, I've been reading Architectural Digest since I was 9 years old. That's why I was the first to talk about gentrification. I've made history in Leimert Park by stopping the city from taking stuff, kicking the vendors out the park for 3 years. You know, I've been on Al Jazeera's and they closed it down, shut Al Jazeera's down after they interviewed me and all of that stuff, all the heck that broke loose because they knew that there was a young man out here who stopped gentrification in the black neighborhood. And they called me the Apache Beard Guy. They say that Apache Beer guy, he really knew his stuff. You know what I'm saying? So I am very researchable. You can research me and find out just how far back my name goes. I didn't just magically appear today and all of a sudden I'm the biggest and baddest thing out here. I have a history in that. I tell you, I'm the guru of low riding. I was the guy behind the scenes building all these cars. You can research that and you will find magazines with my face in there like, You know what I'm saying? I ain't did that. But you will find magazines with my face in it showing. Vicky, how you doing, sis? You know what I'm saying? So we have to know who we are dealing with. You have to research people. You can't, just because someone says, oh, I can help you, don't give them the money. Instagram, you are about to go out. I appreciate it. If y'all want to come check me out, please go to the website, thomastjlofton.com. Everybody, I'm about to tune out in a minute anyway. thomastjlofton.com, February 8th, Decatur, Georgia, Atlanta, Georgia. Instagram is out, y'all. Anyway, y'all, I'll just be going and going and going and going. Does anyone have any questions for me? Because I'm here to help. If not, I will see y'all at the class. Please reach out to me. January 25th, I will be at the LAX Crown Plaza Hotel. You know, that big fancy hotel for y'all who like that stuff. Come on out, get you a ticket, fly out for January 25th, or come on out and register. And let's make this happen. If you don't want to go, or you don't need to go or can't go, pay for someone else to go. Donate some money for someone else to go. Send your nephew, your cousin, family. There's so many people that just don't know what to do, and they need this information I got, and they just need need your help. If you put your little cousin in there, your little bad cousin or whatever, or your little sister that ain't doing too well, doing stuff, but she listens, put her in my class. Put her in this training. In this presentation and show them something different in life. You know, call me up. Let's get some group discounts and where I can have maybe a bunch of the kids off the block to come in, a bunch of them 15-year-olds who are out there trying to sell drugs or do something illegal that can end their life in prison for the rest of their life or something. Bring them to the class. I can relate to them young men. I got a lot to talk about. So bring everybody. Bring these young ladies who thinking about going out there being prostitutes and all of that kind of stuff. Bring everybody, family. Bring some people with you. It's not just about you. Won't you bring some other people? When I grew up, I had people who knew TJ Young. He's different from people. I'm going to take him over here to this thing with me. You know what I'm saying? He old enough to understand what's happening. I'm going to take TJ with you. And I had people always ask, are you taking TJ? Yeah, get him off. He don't need to be out there with them boys. You know he hanging out on the street with them guys again. You need to take him with you to this such and such. And I had a lot of people picking me up, taking me places. You know what I'm saying? Mr. Freddie took me fishing. You know what I'm saying? Took me and the homeboys fishing with him. Changed our life. Here I am, 48 years old, talking about something Mr. Freddie did when I was 8. Mr. Freddie took me fishing when I was 8 years old, y'all. And I'm still talking about it 40 years later because he influenced me. So I would like to see y'all bring some of these young men that ain't got to be your son or your daughter. Bring them to the classes. Bring them to the trainings. Call me up. Let's get a group discount or something. I want to make sure it happens, but it's up to y'all to get these people to come to the classes. So come on, let's make this stuff happen, family. I appreciate y'all. Again, I'll be at Crown Plaza LAX Hotel January 25th. That is $99. I think as of tonight or tomorrow, it will be at $149. So please go ahead and register ASAP because seating is very limited. I'm only going to bring 25 people in there. That's all I want. I got that room for specifically so I can deal with just a small amount of people. I don't need 500 people in the room. I only want 25 people. So because I want to be able to talk to everybody, answer everybody's question, make sure everybody's happy. You know what I'm saying? They didn't learn what they needed to learn, and boom, we good. February 8th, I will be in Decatur, Georgia at the Listening Tree Bookstore, 2 to 4 p.m. Then that evening, 6:30 to 8:30, I'll be in Atlanta, Georgia, upstairs from Tosili's Raw Food Reality at the I Am Ascension Temple. All of these things you can register for on my website. Sunday, I will be in Sumter, South Carolina. If you in North Carolina, if you in Tennessee, if you in South Atlanta, you need to go to Sumter, Sumter. That's going to be the next booming town of real estate, y'all. It's a lot of money being made out there, and it's early. These are the early stages. I'm giving y'all the game now. I'm not out there thinking that I'm finna go buy $1 billion worth of real estate myself. I'm saying, come on, y'all, let's go together, and I'm going to teach you the game. Same thing going on with Georgia, booming real estate. Same thing going on with California, booming real estate. So I'm saying, come on out there, y'all. I'm giving y'all the game. I'm teaching y'all what's going on. So if you come on out there, I'm not just making investments for myself. I'm teaching y'all how to do the same thing. So come on out. Let's talk about it, family. Sumter, South Carolina, coming up February 9th. I will be there, and it's about to happen. So come on now. I'll see y'all soon. Go to my website, thomastjlofton.com. Matter of fact, if you're on Instagram, you can go up to my link tree and click that, and they got a thing about my website, my Eventbrite, and everything that got to do with me. You can even buy a copy of my book on there. But I'm out, y'all. Hope y'all have a great evening. Peace, family. What's up, Paul?